Uishi for the Japanese and Sarange for Korean.
Juicy, flavorful burgers, plump, crunchy sausages, soft, tasty buns, and Asian ingredients? Why, yes, please. Welcome, my foodie friends. Our mission today in Casa Daza Summer, should we choose to accept it? Tickle our taste buds with delightful, unexpected food combinations. I know you guys are always up to delicious adventures, so I thought some playful East meets West fusion experiments would be perfect for a tasty summer afternoon. Hot dogs with a Japanese twist? Sliders with a dose of Korean goodness? Challenge accepted!
So the moment you try all these recipes, guaranteed, they're gonna be oishi.
First up is an unconventional beauty called the japadog. Funnily enough, the inspiration for this quirky dog came not from Japan, but from another part of the world, the Great White North. Say what?
I lived in Vancouver for about 10 years, and one of the jobs I used to do, I was a courier, no? I would deliver documents every day, and siguro the whole entire Monday to Friday, and early morning at about 7 o'clock, I'd go to work. I do my deliveries, come back at about 10:30, and by the time I get back, I would see a long line downtown, and I knew they were selling japadogs. There was this Japanese gentleman. I don't believe he made it in Japan, because you know I frequented the many streets of Japan and I have never seen it. So I guess he just invented it using Japanese ingredients.
The creative combination of American comfort food and Japanese ingredients made such an impression on me, I really set out to crack the japadog code. Here's what I got. For the dog part of the japadog, I'm using steamed buns and my favorite kind of hot dog, a crunchy, spicy Hungarian sausage. Onions caramelized in butter and oil round out the dog part of japadog. While the japa part starts to the basic teriyaki sauce made with Japanese soy sauce, rice wine or mirin as it's called in Japan, rice vinegar, chopped garlic, grated ginger, sugar, and cornstarch. Top with Japanese mayonnaise, chopped nori, and bonito flakes, and your run-of-the-mill hot dog will be turning Japanese in no time.
You know, every time we talk about Japanese cuisine, there is one outstanding sauce that comes to mind, no? And that's teriyaki sauce. And it is such a important ingredient in Japanese cooking. So I'm going to make a very basic teriyaki sauce, okay? We'll start off with 1/3 cup of soy sauce. And then we have some mirin wine. 1/3 cup of mirin wine as well. Okay. We have rice vinegar. Maybe 2 teaspoons of rice vinegar. This one is very strong. Okay. And then we have 1/2 tablespoon of garlic. And then 1/2 tablespoon of ginger also, grated ginger. Some sugar, 1 tablespoon of sugar. And then we have some water and cornstarch, okay?
Once the pan starts to boil, thicken the teriyaki sauce with a slurry made from 1 tablespoon of cornstarch and 1 tablespoon of water. Cook for at least 1 minute, set it aside, then move on to step number 2.
I'm just going to make caramelized onions made up of butter and oil, and I'm just going to slowly cook the onion rings for about 15 minutes until the sugars come out. You know you have a good pan when it takes a while before it heats up because the materials thick, and it's better that way because when it absorbs the heat, the distribution of the heat is equal.
What does that mean for us home cooks? Food will always cook evenly. Sayonara, burnt food. Trust me, quality cookware is always a good investment.
You know, this is how you actually make onion soup. I remember when they were making onion soup in a restaurant in Ubombivant. Talagang you need a lot of patience because you have to wait until the sugars from the onions come out and turn brown. In fact, I remember I have a friend from Paris. We used to work together in our restaurant, yung Katsuren. It was near the L'Opera or Madeleine. And her name was Nicole, and she taught me this French dish called poulet à l'oignon. So you make a lot of yung glazed onions, you let the sugars come out until it turns brown, and then you cover that on the chicken, then you just cook it like that, and you have an onion chicken. So good. Yun lang. Okay, after about 15-20 minutes, the sugars from the onions have come out, so they're caramelized onions now. What we're going to do then is assemble. Okay?
For plump and juicy sausages, boiling is the best method of cooking. Wait for the pot to come to a rolling boil, put the dogs in, reduce to a gentle simmer, and cook for about 10 minutes. And while you're at it, why not steam the hot dog buns? Soft, warm bread is always a good companion to snappy sausages.
Yan! I have some boiled Hungarian sausages. What I'm going to do here is just put serration so that we can cut it so that they're straight, no? Yeah. Let me get the plate, okay? Get some of this onions, caramelized onions. You know, I'm beginning to swallow. You know how when you're anticipating something's really good? You swallow. We just put in some teriyaki sauce. We get some Japanese mayo. Get some of this nori flakes. Put it all over. You know, these are seasoned nori flakes, no? So, they're also very good. Some bonito flakes. And that's it.
Quick, quirky, quality eats all under 30 minutes. It really is amazing what a few unexpected ingredients can do to breathe new life into an old favorite. Say konnichiwa to your new favorite hot dog.
And this here is your japadog. Oishi.
Next up, an American classic gets a K-pop upgrade. We're cooking up more yummy mischief here in the Casa Daza kitchen, and I can't wait for you to try this next one. Sometimes it's fun to stir the pot, no? Taking a classic recipe and adding a few crazy ingredients can lead to the most surprising dishes. Of course, they can be epic fails too. But that's why I'm here, to make all those mistakes for you. Especially when it comes to my personal favorites like hamburgers.
Burgers and hot dogs originated in the United States, but I guess it's crossed to other countries and it's influenced many. Like for example, when I was in Spain, I'd ask them, what's a snack here? Oh, hamburguesa. So that's their version of hamburger.
The next recipe is something I've been working on for a while now, so I'm sure this is going to turn out well. The inspiration? Our collective obsession with all things Korean. Yes guys, pati ako kinain na ng sistema.
Well, the presence of a lot of Korean restaurants all over Manila now, even in the provinces, inspired me to come up with this recipe, no? I've seen the Korean cuisine adapt a lot of the Japanese. They have tempura, they have their own version of tonkatsu, sushis, diba? And they've expanded to adapting Western ingredients or recipes, katulad ng mga burger. So, with that, I thought of an ingredient or a Korean ingredient, yung gochujang, which is distinct Korean, and most of their dishes have that. So, when the moment you taste that or you smell that, you know, it's Korean. Brilliant idea, I think, kasi kakaiba. You know, it's about surprising whoever you're feeding. I think this will surprise you.
Ready to make my version of this delicious Ameri-Korean comfort food? We're going to need a mixture of 1/2 kilo of ground beef and 1/3 kilo of ground pork. Just like your favorite K-pop group, our sliders will need the different Hallyu flavors of ginger, soy sauce, sesame oil, spring onions, gochujang, and egg. To make it even more mashita or delicious, we're going to make a Korean mayo blend made from Japanese mayonnaise, gochujang, samjang, sesame oil, and mirin. Finally, we'll put it all together with our favorite burger fixins, and you guessed it, some kimchi. Let's do this, guys! Fighting!
Let's start with the Korean burger. We have some ground beef. Okay. We're just going to mix all of these together. And then ground pork. You know, one thing you should remember in making a burger is don't put too much liquid, otherwise it becomes too soft and it doesn't hold. Okay, so a tablespoon of soy sauce. And then we have some sesame oil, maybe about a tablespoon of sesame oil also. And then some ginger. If you listen to the ingredients, these are Asian ingredients that's dominant in a lot of Korean cuisine. Like the ginger is there, no? In Japanese also, they have a lot of ginger. We have some spring onions, okay? And when you talk about Korean dishes, one binding ingredient that puts all of those Korean dishes together is what they call gochujang. So we put about a tablespoon of this. Wow, that's spicy. Okay, tablespoon of this. We add one egg. If you find that the egg is not enough to bind everything together, then you add a little more, no?
Vigorous mixing can crush the meat, which will reduce texture, or melt the fat, which will reduce flavor. So avoid overworking the meat mixture by using a light touch. Let Sandy Opa show you how.
What you want to do is run your hand along the side of the mixing bowl and fold towards the middle. Okay, let me sample a piece of our marinated patty.
Okay. Remember our tiny hamburger patty hack from episode 2? Very handy for taste testing recipes using ground meat mixtures. I'll keep on saying it, always taste your food.
I'd like to add a little more soy sauce, okay? You know what? I tasted it and it lacks a little seasoning. So what we're going to do is just add a little more soy sauce. The sesame oil is fine. I smell that aroma. Maybe another 1/2 tablespoon. And then this Korean sauce, this gochujang. Gochujang. You have to say it fast, para hindi ka magkamali. Gochujang. Diba?
Once you're happy with the seasoning, start forming patties.
I want to make sure that my balls or my burger patties fit into the burger buns, if not even become a little bit bigger than the burger buns. You know what really, really irritates me is when you bite into a burger and the burger patty is smaller than the bread. No, medyo, it's kind of annoying. Yum. This is gonna be good, I guarantee you.
Good news! Since these are sliders and not regular sized burgers, the patties won't take too long to cook. Fry each side for about 2 minutes and you're done.
We're just going to finish cooking this. Me, I like my burgers medium well at the most. Nothing less than that. And just flip it over, then we'll just assemble this. And trust me, you're going to love this.
Next, make a flavorful Korean mayo blend by mixing together 1 cup Japanese mayonnaise, 1 tablespoon of gochujang, 2 teaspoons of samjang or spicy dipping sauce, 1 tablespoon sesame oil, and 2 tablespoons of mirin. Ta-da! Assembly time! I have here my Korean mayo. I have some toasted bread. Okay, let's put this on the base. This is like your mayonnaise, no? The mayonnaise protects the juices from the ingredient to penetrate. Okay, go like this. Put a kimchi. Not too much, depends. You like a lot of spice, then put a lot of kimchi. Put a tomato. Then top it like this. Okay. And then you have a slider. Look at that. Of course, no one in their right mind will eat just one slider. So of course, you need to make more. Knock yourself out! Korean burger sliders, they're different. Mapapasaranghe ka. Sasarap. Saranghe, by the way, means I love you. Boom. How do the japadog and Korean burgers taste? I can't wait to show you. That's up next when Casa Daza Summer returns. We've all heard the phrase, necessity is the mother of all invention. I'm sure that's exactly the case in the wonderfully surprising world of food. Can you imagine what kind of necessity led to the invention of the original japadog and Korean burger?
Actually, these are not authentic recipes, I believe, because I've never seen them. I've been to Korea, I've never seen these. I've never seen them also in Japan. I've been to Japan many times. But I guess it's out of the creativity of their nationals in different countries na parang, okay, wanna create something that's ours, but not really authentic. Actually, you can call it fusion, eh, di ba? It's good.
Letting your imagination and appetite do all the creative thinking in the kitchen can lead to some very unique dishes. And the results can be just the thing you need to breathe new life into tired old recipes. How exciting, di ba? If you'd like to get a little more creative in your kitchen, I suggest first stocking up on interesting and even unusual ingredients. Fortunately, most supermarkets, delis, and specialty shops carry a lot of foreign ingredients already, especially Asian items. For a taste of Japanese, here's what you should get. Japanese mayonnaise is sweeter and lighter than regular mayonnaise. Using this can elevate even a simple egg sandwich or a boring salad. Mirin is another ingredient widely used in Japanese cooking. This rice wine, lower in alcohol content than regular wine, imparts that elusive hint of sweetness to Japanese dishes. Seaweed gives Japanese food a real kick of umami, and nori is one of their favorite kinds. Bonito flakes, also known as katsubushi, is an easy but sometimes expensive way to give dishes a Japanese flourish. Here's another set of items that will make your pantry and your meals a little more exciting Korean style. One of the most recognizable colors and flavors in Korean cuisine is the gochujang, or red chili paste.
This is what it looks like. It's like a spicy sauce, no? You have this in bibimbap, you have it in mga cold noodles with sashimi. I've tried those. Sarap. So when you taste this, you know it's Korean.
Samjang is a combination of gochujang and bean paste. So it is definitely not as spicy as its red cousin. It is the dipping sauce most associated with samgyeopsal. Not all sesame oils are the same. The Korean kind is slightly more intense in flavor compared to the other sesame oils. And of course, everybody knows the unique, unmistakably Korean flavor of fermented, probiotic-rich kimchi. Having these items on hand in the pantry and ref can be just the inspiration you need to start your next food experiment. So, are you curious to see how our Korean burger sliders and japadog turned out? We're about to find out.
Lately, I've been having this thing about burgers. I've always loved burgers, but I have a preference for sliders. Kasi it makes you feel like you're not eating too much, but actually you're eating more. So, but anyway, look at this. This is my Korean burger.
There's quite a bit of gochujang in these burgers, Serving them in smaller portions might be a blessing in disguise, actually. Let's see.
You know what jumps out? It's the kimchi. Then the spiciness of that gochujang and the burger itself. It is so good. It's a little bit spicy though, but very, very good. Oh my God.
Mm. For the non-lovers of chili spice, you can choose to skip the gochujang entirely or substitute it with the less spicy samjang. Alternatively, you can simply wash down all that spiciness with a nice cold beverage.
For the Korean burgers, I have soju or beer, actual beer. That's very good, if I may say so. Like I mentioned before, diba? When you bite into something, you either close your eyes, you hum, or you dance. But since there are a lot of people around, I'm not gonna dance, but I wanna dance. Ang sarap niya. Very good.
This lovely Korean twist gives a whole new meaning to the old beer and burgers at the beach combination. Boom!
Let's shift to the japadog. I've been waiting for this since kanina pa.
I forgot to tell you, eating the japadog can be a little messy, but that's all part of the fun.
There are complex flavors. There's the creaminess from the mayonnaise, the saltiness from the nori, and the sweetness from the teriyaki sauce. With the softness of the steam bread, the crunchiness and the spiciness of the Hungarian sausage, caramelized onions, Japanese mayo, bonito flakes, and nori, this is so, so good. Oishi. With Japanese beer, I'm home, baby. Ooh. Oishi.
With just a few extra ingredients, we managed to turn our ordinary hot dogs and burgers into exciting new dishes. How's that for an edible adventure in your own kitchen?
Oishi for the Japanese and sarange for Korean.
Fancy a bite of British cuisine? We go full Monty next week with two exciting dishes. Scotch eggs and English fish and chips. See you again here at Casa Daza Summer. Cheerio!
I promise you it's going to be very, very good. Boom!